Thank you everyone for attending this webinar. My name is Kevin Kokyong. I'm Deputy Attaché for Science and Technology at the Embassy of France in the US. We're really excited to have the third webinar now in the series, City of Tomorrow. In this series, we're trying to explore the impact of digital technologies on the future of cities in both France and the US, but also outside. And we're really happy to have this third webinar where we're going to talk about electromobility, but also the use of university campuses for testing innovative approaches to solving issues of urban mobility. And to start off, we will have opening remarks by Kathleen O'Connor, who is the Vice President for International Relations at Université de Lille. And without further ado, Kathleen, I will leave the floor to you.
Great, thank you very much. So good morning, afternoon and evening, I think it's appropriate. It's a great pleasure to open this webinar on new urban mobility as part of the French Embassy's series on the cities of tomorrow. So this event is particularly close to my heart, given the two countries involved. So as you may have guessed from my accent, I'm from the United States, where I grew up and completed a large part of my university education. But for the past 20 years, I've lived and worked in Lille, France, where I completed my doctorate at the University of Lille and was hired soon after. So it's naturally a source of satisfaction to see these exchanges between researchers in my home country and my adopted country. So the topics of these seminars are particularly strategic for Lille and the University of Lille. So we are located north of Paris in the Hauts-de-France region. Lille's department called Le Nord has the highest population in France and is also one of the most densely populated outside of Paris. The Eurometropolis that includes Lille and the cities of Kortrijk and Tournai in Belgium is home to 2.5 million people. So we are particularly well placed, I think, to understand the issues facing urban areas. Moreover, in 1983, Lille became the first city with a fully automated driverless subway. So this subway was developed by Professor Gabillard at the University of Lille and is now used worldwide. For example, at O'Hare Airport in Chicago, it's used for inside the airport transportation. So speaking of the university in particular, with approximately 80,000 students, we are the largest university in France. So we actually contain the population of a small city all on our own, just at the university. And in fact, our science and technology campus is named Cité, City Scientifique. And this is the living laboratory where Alain Bousquerolle and his colleagues carry out their work on sustainable mobility as part of the CUMAN project that I think you'll hear about today, with the goal of becoming the first university campus that is carbon neutral with respect to mobility. So this project is in line with our wider strengths in research. The University of Lille has a national label of excellence with 4 strategic research themes recognized for their high quality. So precision human health, changing cultures, societies and practices, science for a changing planet and human-friendly digital world. The CUMAN project portfolio overlaps with these last two on climate science and digital technologies. This is a national project which also helped fund Professor Eric Hittinger's, I think I said it right, involvement in the CUMAN project, which has been an important contribution to its advancement. So the university also hosts a nationally funded institute on artificial intelligence alongside other regional higher education institutions. So the Humain Institute has financing for a number of PhD contracts in artificial intelligence, of which 22 will be carried out at the University of Lille. And so this also, I think, touches on questions related to mobility and the CUMAN project. So I won't take up much more of your time because I think you have important work to do that will benefit all of us. I invite the participants from the US and elsewhere to visit our website and learn more about the university. We are always interested in creating partnerships in research, academics, and student exchange with partners across the globe, and we'd be happy to discuss these possibilities. And you'll also see that CUMAN already has a number of international partners. So I wish you a very fruitful seminar today, and I look forward to finding out what lies in store for the cities of tomorrow. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Kathleen, for your kind words and support for this initiative that we're launching. And with that, I will invite Alain Bousquerolle to take the floor. Alain has been since 2015 the coordinator for the Cumin Interdisciplinary Program at the University of Lille. Since 2018, he has been co-director of the International Research Lab eCampus on Sustainable Mobility, and also coordinator of PANDA, a European H2020 project on simulation and testing of electrified vehicles. With that said, Alain, the floor is yours.
Okay. Thanks, Kevin and Kathleen, for your nice introduction. So I will introduce the Cumin project. Cumin means campus of university with mobility based on innovation and carbon neutrality. This project is focused on one of the campuses of the University of Lille. It is the Cité Scientific Campus, which receives every day about 20,000 students and more than 2,000 academic staff on 80 buildings and an area of 110 hectares. As said by Kathleen, is a small city, in fact. In 2011 and 2015, we do some greenhouse gases survey of the campus. And it was a surprise for us, because we are very old building. The major sector was mobility. And then we focus the study on the mobility, and we have a study in the in-depth the mobility, and we found that only 3% of the emission due to the mobility was related to professional trips, but most of the part, 97%, are related to the home university trips. You have to know that globally, 1/3 of people come by car, 1/3 by buses, and 1/3 by subway or train. Unfortunately, the people that come by car contribute to more than 75% of the emission due to the transport. So, in conclusion, if we really want to cut off the greenhouse gases of the campus, we have to reduce strongly the emission due to the daily commuting trips. That's why we develop the Cumin project in order to increase the use of electric vehicles in the campus. By the campus users, the commuting people, to propose also to charge this vehicle by using renewable energy charging station, and to collect a lot of data for this change in order to have a living lab and to share what is our experience in this transition, because we know that every city has to do a transition. We organize the program in two phases. We are in the first phase where we try to understand and to study the use and the possibilities, and to also aware our users, mainly students and academic staff. And then we will try to do the implementation phase in order to progressively change the campus in a greener campus. So what could be our future campus is just one ideal solution, is no possibility for thermal cars to come in the campus, the possibility for electric cars to come and to charge using PV panels and so on, some mobility facilities for internal connection like autonomous vehicles, e-bike and so on, sharing services. Of course, it's just the ideal solution. So we have also to work on the trade-off between the actual campus and the ideal solution. What could be the trade-off? We have to take into account also the feasibility, the economics part, and so on. And we are working on that. So first, we develop only three projects on Cumaine. It was Eve, Adam, and Greta. To know what is the renewable energy potential, what are the EV electric vehicle consumption and requirement, and also what was the driver usage. And step by step, we develop many projects related to the Cumaine program and to contribute to the program on technical aspect or the kind of vehicles, the consideration of the automatic subway in Lille, what could be also the connection, the user acceptance, social acceptance, economical models, autonomous vehicle, and so on. So, and we have some projects that will join us. What is the most important is we try to really work in an interdisciplinary team. At the beginning, we were two engineering labs of the University of Lille, Crystal and L2P. One human and social science lab, TVUS. Then we have been joined by Metropole Européenne of Lille that is very interested in this experience and demonstrator. Then we built an international lab with Canada, University of Trois-Rivières, with two other labs, one in engineering and one other in social and human science, in order to compare the usage, the requirement, and the possibility for two different campuses. And we have also a collaboration with Rochester Institute of Technology, with Eric, more on the economics and public policies aspects, and also University of Kent, and we have other connections that will be mentioned in the coming year. But anyway, we try to work together, and it's really exciting to do that. Sometimes it's difficult because we have not exactly the same language, but it's not a problem of English or French. It's a scientific and problem. So today, we will just present some results of three of the Cumaine program, three projects of the Cumaine program. I will present some results about the F program on energy consumption of vehicles. Eric will discuss with the economical models in the test project. Eugenie will present first result of social acceptance and how we plan to do that. And also Rojdi from University of Gustave Eiffel will present some of our collaboration between of Boston University within the framework of this program in terms of driver behavior. So now more technical part of my presentation. So it's on the EVE project on EV consumption, specifically for different climatic conditions. It's a collaboration with University of Trois-Rivières in Canada with Professor Loïc Boulon, and we have a joint PhD, David Ramsey, and I will present his first results. So one of the stress of EV is driving range. We know that driving range is shorter than thermal car. And we know also this driving range is specifically affected by the climatic condition. Why? Because the battery has to give energy to move the car, supplying the electrical motor, but also to warm the car or to refresh the car using HVAC, heat, ventilation, and air conditioning. And it shows that in winter or in summer, as you need energy to warm or to refresh the cabin, the driving range will be reduced significantly. So in this project, we tried to build a detailed and flexible simulation model in order to better understand the impact of the different parameters on the energy consumption, one of the problems and one of the challenges is to connect and interconnect very different kind of model, thermal model, electrical model, mechanical model, electrochemistry model, with different level of accuracy. And we use a specific graphical formalism, EMR, energetic macroscopic representation, in order to interconnect in the right way the different subsystems to have a real understandable and flexible simulation tool. So I will not detail all the model for you, it will be very bored, but I will show you what is the complexity. I will just open one box, is HVAC box, and inside the box, you can see there are many small boxes with different models, and these models exchange information and energy, and there are strong coupling between the heating system, the air conditioning system, the thermal behavior of the vehicles, the thermal behavior of the environment of the vehicle, and so on. And each change will have an impact on the other part. So of course, we need some methods in order to do that in the right way. So we do the complete simulation of the vehicle, and we validate with a real vehicle. It is a Renault Zoe, a French EV. And we do different driving cycle on different temperature. You can see we do that in winter. In winter in France, it's only -5 degrees. So of course in US or in Canada, it's not the same. But for the different tests, we find that the model is accurate enough because the simulation leads to only an error of 3%. 3% at the system level is very good. So we are confident in our simulation model, and now we can play testing different driving scenario, urban, highway, extra-urban, and also climatic condition, in order to know what happens and specifically which systems has the more energy consumption. So you can see in blue the energy related to the traction of the car. In red, the energy required to heat or refresh the cabin, and in green, the ancillaries. Of course, in normal condition at 20 degrees, there is no need of a heating cabin and so on. So it is a minimal energy consumption. But if you look for urban driving cycle, the first plot, you can see that in order to warm the cabin, we need twice time the energy of the traction. And of course, we will significantly reduce the driving cycle. So we are testing different conditions and working, and it will be interesting for us to know what could be an alternative to solve some problem in some climatic condition. So we have studied the vehicle with our flexible model. We can see that there is a strong reduction of the driving range in winter, specifically for urban driving cycle, not so much for highway driving cycle. It can be explained. And air conditioning is not so impacting on the system. What is the next step? So we have to increase the validation range to study the battery temperature, but we are working today on a pre-heating system. What is the interest to pre-heat the cabin before driving? What is the energy consumption, the cost, and so on? So it was my last technical slide. I just would like to take the opportunity to promote our next international summer school, which is managed by our International Academy Service. So it is related to mobility, 10 days in July. So if some of the students that attend to this webinar are interested, they are invited to have a look on our website in order to join us during the summer school. Okay, thanks for your attention, and I hope that you appreciate our program and maybe could have more interaction in that way.
Thank you very much, Anna, for your presentation on CUMEL and on the first results you've been able to gather. As you mentioned, there's still a lot of work to do and a lot of complexity that we need to solve to better understand like all these issues. Hopefully, through the collaboration with the many colleagues you mentioned in your presentation abroad, we can manage to solve that. And hopefully through this webinar, you'll be able also to make new connections with interested colleagues. I would like to also take this opportunity to mention to attendees that if you have any questions during the events on any of the presentation, please write a message in the chat and we'll try to address them as we go. And if we're not able, we'll be getting back to you afterwards. The event is also recorded, so we'll provide a replay for free to all attendees. And with that said, if there is no question at the moment, we will move to the next presentation by Dr. Eric Hittinger. Dr. Hittinger is associate professor in public policy and is an affiliated faculty at the Golisano Institute for Sustainability at Rochester Institute of Technology. He has a background in electricity technology, policy, operation, and economics, with a focus on understanding the benefits and limitations of emerging technologies, including energy storage, electric vehicles, and renewable electricity sources. So, Eric, when you're ready.
Thank you. Okay. So hi, everyone. I'm going to talk about the TESS project, which is one of the projects in the large circle of projects that Hélène showed. So there's a lot of different things going on as part of CUMEN. But the TESS project had the intentional goal of trying to develop some economic models to better understand how this mobility transition would affect costs and expenditures, both from the perspective of the commuters, the consumers that are coming to the campus, and also from the perspective of the university, who will probably have to invest in some infrastructure in order to respond to the changes that are proposed. The goal of TESS, you know, is partly the research, but it's also partly bringing together these different streams of research. So TESS is intentionally interdisciplinary. So there is, of course, the technology-focused, the engineering research at El Giuseppe that's focused on things like electric vehicles, solar power, batteries. How do these systems work on their own? How can they be integrated? And what can we get them to do for us? It's, you know, rather formal electrical engineering and systems engineering. Also at the University of Lille is the research at TVES, the social science research that we're going to hear about soon from Eugenie, focused on things like the needs for transportation among the community, the commuters, and also the community in the region as a whole, and also the preferences and choices and behavior of those people. And finally, the perspective that I bring is to try and bring in an economic perspective, to do economic and financial modeling. We often call it techno-economic modeling of all of these choices, these technologies, and these decisions. So my background is rather interdisciplinary. I actually started as an engineer, but I had changed and studied policy and economics, and now I teach in a policy department. So it's very natural for me to help bring all of these perspectives together on such an important topic. And the goal of TESS is to develop and implement a plan for decarbonizing transportation to the Cité Scientifique campus at the university. Although I want to note here that while the research is focused on this as a topic, it has a lot of extensions beyond this one university campus. University campuses, like the Cité Scientifique, are excellent test beds for studying things like urban dynamics. A university campus has commuting, that a daily cycle of people coming and going. It has buildings, it has to manage energy use, water use, it has to feed all the people. And all these things that apply to a campus on the smaller scale tend to apply in similar ways to cities on a larger scale. But university campuses have two additional features that make studying them a little more fruitful than immediately applying them to a university. And that is, first of all, it tends to be the case that they're administered, controlled, and owned by a central administration. So if you want to implement a policy that applies to every office, every building, every parking space in a university campus, that's a lot easier than trying to apply a similar policy to every parking space in a city. And then secondly, universities tend to be rather progressive about energy and environmental matters and are very interested in pushing the envelope, trying to pursue rather challenging goals about decarbonization and reduced energy use. So for these reasons, they can be great test beds for what we will later deploy into cities themselves. But the three main questions that we were focused on in the first phase here is, first of all, how do we convince thermal car drivers to change? You know, we'd love to get them on the bus or onto the metro, but realistically, a lot of them commute from remote villages where it's challenging to do that. So we might put them into electric vehicles, but you know, how is that going to work for them? Secondly, on the university side, how do we design a system that can handle this shift? If thousands of electric vehicles start showing up to campus and they're looking to charge their vehicles on campus, then the university needs to be prepared with a plan to respond to that. And thirdly, we want to do this in a way that is least painful for people, least painful for the university and for the commuters, right? We're going to do this at low cost and low inconvenience. So, you know, a first obvious question about getting commuters to change vehicles is an electric car a good investment? And I'd love to give a yes or no answer to that, but of course, you know, we're researchers, so we have to give complicated answers to things, but it makes sense that it depends. It depends on how much you drive. It depends on how much you pay for gasoline and electricity. What kind of car do you drive and how long do you keep it, right? There's a lot of factors which would affect whether an electric vehicle is a good choice for you. And some of these factors would be the same for commuters at Lille, like the cost of gas and electricity is basically the same in the region, but it would be different certainly than in the United States, for example. And then the United States tends to have very different gas and electricity prices. And some of these things just depend on the person, right? Every person has a different type of vehicle, a different driving pattern. And if we also want to know if switching to an electric vehicle is a cost-effective way to decrease CO2 emissions, we need to know about the emissions. We need to know about the emissions from the traditional vehicle and also the emissions from the electricity that you're using to charge your car. So if you have a rather low carbon electricity grid, like France, then your electricity is pretty clean. If you look at the United States, there's portions of the US that have rather dirty electricity grids, and the environmental benefit is much smaller in that case. And we've done research looking at these questions both in the US and in France. So for some research here that we did for the United States, we asked, you know, what are the economics of switching people into alternative vehicles? And by alternative vehicles, we meant regular hybrids, so a hybrid that runs on gasoline, a plug-in electric hybrid, or a pure battery electric vehicle. So this is for the United States for the year 2018. So the alternative vehicles were not particularly cheap. But what we found for the US, which probably won't surprise the American audience, is that in the US, gasoline is cheap, electricity is sometimes cheap, and only about 2% of the population received economic benefits from switching from a thermal vehicle, upgrading in the base case scenario. And when we investigated the distribution and which vehicles they should switch to, so in this graph, there's still the same 2% on the lower left here, but the colors in this graph indicate which type of vehicle commuters in the US should switch to. And you can see it's almost entirely green. There's a few pink and blue lines in there, but it's mostly green. And the green is the regular hybrid electric vehicle that runs on gasoline. So the story for the US in the base case was that at least according to the prices of everything a few years ago, drivers probably mostly don't want to upgrade to these alternative vehicles, but when they do, they mostly want to upgrade to a hybrid. Now this is without any government incentive. If we incentivize the upgrade, then we can get people to switch, but it's not a particularly optimistic view. I can note, I don't have a slide for this, but I'll note that if the gas price in the US went up to the same price that it is in France, then the equation switches drastically. Then you actually have the majority of consumers saving money by switching to these alternative vehicles, which is sort of interesting. We've also investigated this a little bit for France, the Lille region. So this figure here was actually made by Elodie Castex at the University of Lille, and it shows where the commuters to the university live, right? And of course, they mostly live near the university, is in the center of this red blob, but they come from a variety of locations. And we did some analysis. So this work was led by Anatole Desrevaux of the University of Lille, and we did some analysis of the economics in France, in the Lille region. And we found again that the economics depend on how you drive, but in this case, they were much more favorable towards the electric vehicles. So the upper graph here shows how much money the consumer would save by switching from a diesel to an electric vehicle under four different driving patterns. So again, it kind of depends how you drive. Are you an urban driver or a highway driver? And on the bottom, it also depends on how long you tend to own the vehicle. And so we looked at three scenarios, a diesel vehicle, the electric vehicle like the Zoe, where you purchase the vehicle and the battery. But people in France will know that you can also lease the battery, which we analyzed separately. And the best choice between those depends on how long you tend to own the vehicle. But in all the cases that we looked at, one of the electric vehicle options tends to be superior on cost savings. So all of this, though, has been about the perspective of the commuters. We can also ask a few questions from the perspective of the university. So if the university expects a growing electric vehicle demand, hundreds or perhaps thousands of people showing up looking to charge their vehicle, what infrastructure should the university build in response? And most importantly, when should they build it, given things like economy of scale and falling cost of new technology? So economy of scale for infrastructure means if I'm putting in a bank of EV chargers, it tends to be cheaper for me to put in 100 EV chargers in one big project than to do 10 projects in 10 different years that each have 10 chargers. Do it all at once, you save money on larger projects. But we also have falling costs of new technology. So things get cheaper over time, solar, batteries, even the infrastructure for charging vehicles gets cheaper over time. So that's kind of an argument for waiting. A second question, is it better for the university to try and purchase clean electricity from grid suppliers to charge these vehicles or to generate it locally with rooftop solar on top of the buildings at the campus? And thirdly, what business model for charging will attract consumers while raising some income? So we built a model to help us understand these questions that tracks over time the arrival and departure of vehicles and routes energy between the solar power, the storage, the electric vehicles, and the electricity grid over time. So this is all just in the computer. But we can model when cars arrive and track how energy flows. So this figure at the bottom shows a 1 week of operation, and you can kind of see the solar peaks. The blue lines are the 7 days of solar showing up in the middle of the day. You can also tell that it's Lille, it's the north, so it's not very sunny each day. In fact, there's 3 good days of sun and then a couple cloudy days where there's not so much solar production. And then we can track where the energy goes over time. Does the energy go into the two classes of vehicles that we study? Does the energy go into the stationary storage batteries that you might have on site? Or eventually in the weekend, these last 2 days are Saturday and Sunday, there's not vehicles showing up on campus to charge, and we've charged our batteries. So the solar power either goes into the university buildings or gets curtailed. And we use this model to ask a few questions about how the system would work with differing amounts of solar, battery, and electric vehicles. And we run this over time. We basically run that model that I just described, and then we choose what infrastructure to build before the next year, and then we add some new electric vehicles to the system and throw them at the system, and we run this in a loop and progress it forward in time. And we add an optimization routine to it. So we have an optimization that helps us figure out, well, what infrastructure do we need to build in order to meet the needs of the EVs while minimizing cost of the system from the university perspective? And the answer that it gives us is sort of interesting. What it tells us is, even though with the purple line is how many EVs are showing up at this building, so this is the result just for one building, the number of EVs that show up at a building increases gradually and continually over time. What the model says actually is to build larger projects every 5 or 10 years. And that's because of the economy of scale. So the orange bars show how many chargers are installed, and it basically only builds new chargers in years 1, 4, and 12. But it builds a lot of them. It builds enough to cover the next 5 or 10 years of demand. For solar, it doesn't build any until year 11, and then it builds a huge installation because of economies of scale that will cover the demand of the EVs for years to come. So finally, I just want to note that this work on tests has a few benefits beyond the set scientifique, such as applications to other locations. So in these pictures on the right at the top is my campus at Rochester Institute of Technology, which in many ways is similar to the University of Lille. It's about 10 kilometers outside of the city. You can actually see the skyline of Rochester in the distance here in this picture. And so it's kind of a suburban campus. It's relatively dense. The buildings are kind of similar. But there's a few important differences, like there is no metro line that comes out here, so that there's not a real option for that. The climate is pretty different. And the culture is very different, right? In the US, it's a very car-centric culture. But we can also apply this knowledge to cities. So at the bottom is the center of the city of Lille, So the results that we come up with for the campus can be applied to cities like Lille or Rochester or Paris or New York. What we're doing here is trying to also build interdisciplinary connections. So we're connecting people that speak different languages, as Ellen noted earlier. And I think by working together, we can come up with knowledge that's greater than what we're working on individually, greater than the sum of their parts. And of course, finally, we have this great France-US connection where we're building out international connections, which help us cross-pollinate research and exchange research ideas. But I think it also helps us exchange some cultural ideas at the same time. So anyway, that's all I have for the presentation. I hope that was useful. And I want to thank everyone for listening.
Well, thank you again, Eric, for your very interesting presentation. I think from my side, and maybe for the attendees, one interesting thing would be to ask about those interactions that you have with, you know, the city of Lille, the policymakers, and how other cities that might be interested could collaborate with you guys and see, maybe replicate some of the work, or, you know, that things like this. I just want to mention also a question that was asked by one of the attendees, and that was for Alain. The question was, if we consider two different geographic places with about the same temperature but different level of humidity, does that difference of humidity lead to a difference on the vehicle energy consumption? And if yes, does the model you presented consider the humidity of a given geographic place? And Alain, if you want to take that, and also Eric, if you want to jump in on the previous question.
Yes, we have considered the humidity of the earth in our models. I don't present the results because in fact, the impact is very lower than the impact of the temperature. But in hot condition, it could have an impact because it has an influence on the operating of the air conditioning system, and it increases a little bit the energy consumption. And we do that for different humidity condition. We take, if I remember, the example of Vietnam with high humidity, and also Dubai, with a very different humidity air, and we have some difference, but not so important in comparison with temperature. But the interest to have a flexible tool is to be able to study independently each factor. Thanks for the question.
Yes, and I can address the question about working with cities a little bit. So as far as Lille goes, I'm sort of, Alain knows better than I do, but the research team has very good connections with MEL, the Metropole de Lille, and has worked very closely with them on developing their transportation plans, as well as some of the technology strategies. And so, you know, in fact, they funded part of this work, the test project. And here in Rochester, we also do work with the city of Rochester in a similar fashion. The city, just like my university here, the city has a climate action plan, as does the university. And of course, there is some coordination between the strategies of the university and what we're trying to do at the university level to decarbonize transportation. And because we're both a research institute that can provide answers and a part of the community in the Rochester area that we work sometimes with the transportation planning within the city of Rochester as well. But of course, you know, other people are welcome to contact us and you know, have us help them with their transportation issues as well.
Thank you, Alain. Thank you, Eric. I'm noting as well that Iman Ben Rabia asked what is the best way to approach a new project like the test project, but for a city, what the factors are that we need to focus in order. But maybe that's something that we can also discuss a bit later There's like a dedicated time also for more general Q&A question afterwards. But I'd just like to introduce Eugénie Maclet. Eugénie received her master's degree in urbanism in 2019 from the University of Lille in France. She's currently a PhD student in urban planning of sustainable campuses. And this is a thesis in co-supervision between the University of Lille and the University of Trois-Rivières in Canada within the framework of the eCampus International Associated Laboratory. Eugénie, the floor is yours.
Thank you for the presentation. So, hello, my name is Eugénie Masquet. I am a PhD student in urban planning on sustainable campuses in co-supervision between University of Lille and University of Trois-Rivières in Canada, within the framework of the eCampus International Associated Laboratory. My thesis director are Dr. Elodie Castex and Professor Sylvie Mieux. I'm also involved in CUMA International Interdisciplinary Program, and my main research activity deals with urban planning and sustainability at TVES Laboratory. TVES means territories, cities, environment, and society. My presentation will focus on the social acceptability of electric vehicles in restricted areas, which are university campuses. This research work is part of the project SARA, and Elodie Castex would have liked to be present today and apologize for her absence. The presentation will be in four parts. First, I will present the campuses today and the methodology used to measure the social acceptability of the electric vehicles. Then I will discuss the first result obtained during the consultation workshop. Finally, I will briefly present the research perspectives. To extend the multidisciplinary collaboration of the CUMA program, the Associated International Laboratory eCampus was created. eCampus stands for Electromobility for Campus of University based on sustainability. It is a collaborative laboratory between the University of Lille in France and the University du Québec à Trois-Rivières in Canada. As Alain Bouscaro said earlier, eCampus brings together four laboratories: two French, the TVS and L2EP laboratories, and two Canadian, the ALGAS and RH laboratories. These laboratories form the International Associated Laboratory eCampus. eCampus analyzes university campuses and establish a method to reduce the ecological footprint of university through the use of electric vehicles. The study of several campuses is necessary to define all issues related to electromobility. Indeed, each university campuses face many challenges and has its own constraints to reduce its GHG emissions. Today, two campuses are being studied by eCampus: the Cité Scientifique campus of the University of Lille in France, which was briefly presented to you, and the main campus of the University du Québec à Trois-Rivières in Canada. These campuses operate like small towns. They have place to live, gathering, service, place of work, and study. They welcome a varied public: students, residents, society visitors, etc. These campus users move to, from, and within the campus. Both campuses have been designed for the car and are laid out with a view to developing more sustainable mobility and new uses. Nowadays, these campuses have to cope with the phenomena of traffic densification and saturation. On the other hand, the two campuses differ in their urban morphology. The French campus is spread over 110 hectares, whereas the Quebec campus is compact and occupies only 25 hectares. The socio-cultural and climatic context also differ. These two campuses does make it possible to study the differences in terms of mobility behavior and model choices induced by the context of a Northwest European metropolis and a North American city. This comparison also makes it possible to identify the effect of climate on mobility and to deduce the potential seasonality of travel. This question takes on its full meaning in the perspective of progressive electrification of mobility, since the performance of battery is affected by extreme temperatures. But why did we choose to study campuses in the urban point of view? Because university campuses are ideal place to engage in new and more sustainable practices. Indeed, university campuses are small towns. also stratify sample of the local population, have a diverse infrastructure, history, and culture. Campuses also have the financial resources of a small town and outsource many needs to governments. University generates a lot of daily travel. In addition, with the global environment challenges caused by climate change, higher education institutions have become aware of their sustainability practice. Universities are important sites for transformation as they are a center of discourse and vehicle for social change. Moreover, the United Nations report states that innovation is the key to sustainable change. Campuses are therefore an ideal place to study electric mobility. However, to ensure the adoption of electric mobility on campuses, it is necessary to work on social acceptability and social barriers. A complex mix of emotion and practicality is involved in the choice of a vehicle. EV adoption is shaped simultaneously by extrinsic factors, such as the availability of charging infrastructure and vehicle characteristics, and intrinsic factors such as demographic, but also environmental values, personal preference, and of course the budget. It is therefore essential to investigate user perceptions to support positive social acceptability. Social acceptability is an interdisciplinary concept. It is about understanding the public perception of practice or technologies. Social acceptability is a process of judgment that involves the inference of different factors, comparison with no alternatives, evolution of outcomes, and behaviors components. Social acceptability is based on personal judgment, but it's sensitive to group influence. A project may be considered economically and ecologically viable and may not be implemented because it is not socially acceptable. As social acceptability is a process, it is not fixed in time, it evolves. It is needed to be able to measure social acceptability over a long period of time in order to be able to see how it evolves. Especially since the electric vehicle is the subject of many prejudices. Users have a negative perception of the safety and resilience of EVs, and their assessment of their real driving needs in relation to the autonomy of an EV is often wrong. Users are also resistant to change. It is important to raise awareness of electric mobility among users and to be able to measure the social acceptability of electrification of mobility regularly over a long period of time. The laboratory eCampus is developing an electric mobility living lab with the aim of identifying the different dimensions of electromobility and measuring the social acceptability of a progressive electrification of campuses. The electromobility living lab developed by eCampus is innovative. Indeed, living labs are, when they are not virtual, linking to single lab territory. The living lab eCampus is common to two campuses today. The Cité Scientifique Campus of the University of Lille and the main campus of the Université du Québec à Trois-Rivières. The establishment of the living lab on the campuses studied by the eCampus laboratory will enable the university to involve their user in the campus project. A living lab is a laboratory for open innovation. It's a research method that places the aware user at the center of the device. The user then becomes actor and collaborator. The concept of living lab is used to describe an experimental platform where the user is studying in his daily environment. Living labs have two objectives: to involve users who can then define their needs, wishes, ideas, and to experiment in real life situation. This research method allows testing an innovation, researching the context of use with the possible discovery of unexpected uses and use opportunities, combining quantitative and qualitative research, and bringing together several research partners. In addition, the living labs allow for the development and testing of new research methodology, particularly during the pandemic, which is pushing for the development of new adapted methods. The electromobility living lab eCampus has several objectives. First of all, it allows a long-term assessment of the process of social acceptability of electromobility. Social acceptability can be spontaneous as well as a result of a well-thought-out consultation process. The living lab will allow the social acceptability of the project to evolve. The aim of the living lab is not to convince campus users to change their thermal vehicle for an electric vehicle overnight, but to put with the users a project for progressive electrification of mobility, to test temporalities and electrification scenarios, and to accustom users to electric mobility. The objective of the living lab is to support users in the process of achieving positive acceptance of electric mobility. It will enable a smooth transition from carbon-based to decarbonized mobility. The Living Lab also allows the implementation of different qualitative and quantitative methods on different sites. The data collecting of the two campuses will be compared in order to define the factors influencing the implementation of electric mobility. Common and site-specific factors can be highlighted. Thus, the laboratory in campus will have an initial basis of factors influencing the electrification of mobility. This database can be completed later on by studying other sites. By its dual location, the Living Lab allows both universities to exchange with actors outside their respective campuses. Indeed, it is important for university to dialogue at the societal level and to imagine beyond the limit in order to provide transferable models to city. The Living Lab will build on existing network and create new ones through user involvement, integrating into the existing network of Living Labs and sustainable campuses. One of the first actions of the Living Lab was the organization of consultation workshop with the student on the master's degree in urban planning of the University of Lille. The objective of this workshop was to measure the social acceptability before and after the training on the electric vehicle. By training, we meant participation in a workshop composed in part of presentation on the electric vehicle. During the presentations, the animator never took side and presented the positive points as well as the negative points on all the subject approach, such as charging station, autonomy, charging time, etc. During this consultation workshop, students were asked to complete two surveys, one at the beginning and one at the end of the workshop, to identify changes in the perception and social acceptability of the EV. The consultation workshop were online events and took place just a month ago on Zoom. I'm going now to present you a part of the results, which are first results that will be completed later because other workshops are and will be scheduled. I've also translated the question and answer for this presentation. The survey was in French, so the wording may not be completely faithful. To date, 43 students have participated in the consultation workshop. Of these 43 students, 31 have a driving lesson, 25 are female, and 18 are male. On the 43 student survey, 4 have an electric vehicle in their home and are satisfied with it. Besides these 4 students, 20 other students have already ridden in an electric vehicle. So out of 43 students, 24 have already ridden in an EV, and all of them found the experience enjoyable. This figure shows that the electric vehicle is becoming more common. The survey are composed of 36 questions and are around 80% identical. The objective of the surveys disseminated at the beginning and at the end of the workshop is to measure the evolution of the perception and social acceptability of electric vehicle before and after the training. The student overwhelmingly stated that the workshop contributed to changing their opinion on EVs. And indeed, when we compare the answer to the question, we see that their perception has evolved. One of the questions common to both surveys was, if you want a contest and were given a choice of 3 prizes, a combustion vehicle, an electric vehicle, and a hybrid vehicle, which one would you choose? We contextualized the question to eliminate the price, which is a major barrier to purchase. In the first survey, at the beginning of the consultation, only 4 students choose the electric vehicle, 2 students choose the combustion vehicle, and 30 students choose the hybrid vehicle. At the end of the consultation, no student choose the combustion vehicle, 17 students choose the electric vehicle, and 18 choose the hybrid vehicle. While the first survey showed a clear preference for the hybrid vehicle, by the end of the workshop, this was no longer the case and the students were divided. So what explains the change of heart? Analysis of the response to the 2 surveys shows that students' perception has changed. Indeed, at the beginning of the consultation workshop, more than half of the students said that they will have to change their travel habits if they traveled by electric car. There are 34 out of 43 who said it was difficult to find a charging station. While after the consultation workshop, 30 students said their travel habits would not be changed, and more than half said it was fairly easy to find a charging station. The students were also asked to evaluate the performance of EVs in terms of range, speed limits, and safety. As the beginning of the consultation, 19 students found the range of electric vehicle unsatisfactory, while at the end of the consultation, only 6 students found the autonomy unsatisfactory. Regarding the speed limit, 17 students found the speed limit rather unsatisfactory and 20 rather satisfactory at the first survey. These figures can be explained by the fact that the electric vehicle is often perceived as a less efficient car than a combustible vehicle. In the second survey, 3 people found the speed limit rather unsatisfactory, 15 rather satisfactory, and 20 completely satisfactory. The perception of security has also evolved positively. In the first survey, the student found the security rather satisfactory, and in the second survey, they found it completely satisfactory. The survey response shows that prejudice around electric vehicles are still very present and influence the social acceptability of electric mobility. To ensure the adoption of electric vehicles on campuses, but also on a larger scale, it is necessary to take into account the social acceptability. Social acceptability is evolving, and we have seen that it can evolve positively when users are trained in electric vehicles. However, we must be careful not to praise the advantages and hide the disadvantages. We must let the user form their own opinion. As mentioned before, other workshops in other training, will be conducted. Moreover, within the framework of the Living Lab, this workshop will take place in France as well as in Canada. The Living Lab is a methodology that allows the production of many tests and results over the long term. Finally, today we have presented 3 common projects, but there are others that are often interconnected. In addition, other projects will surely come soon. I'm done. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Eugenie, for your presentation and very interesting work done with those workshops. And again, just being curious to know if that could be possible to replicate this also with American colleagues, maybe Eric with the Rochester Institute of Technology. Maybe that's something that could be possible, but also other colleagues in the US. That could be interesting to see the results there. There's been also a question from the attendance, a bit of a provocative question, and I'm not sure if we'll be able to have some opinions afterwards, but Ashraf El Kamel asked to the panelists, like, based on knowledge of both countries, of both peoples, and the results of your studies, which country would be closer to implement the idea of a green city? And based on all the factors that we mentioned, maybe we can reflect on that a little bit more and come up with some answers afterwards. With that said, Aymeric Rousseau is going to present next. And Aymeric is the manager of the Vehicle and Mobility Systems section at Argonne National Laboratory. He received his engineering diploma at the Industrial System Engineering School in La Rochelle, and his executive MBA at the Chicago Booth in 2019. For the past 20 years, he's been evaluating the impact of advanced vehicle and transportation technologies from a mobility and energy point of view, including the development of autonomy, a vehicle system simulation, and Polaris, a large-scale transportation system simulation. Aymeric, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Good morning and good afternoon, everyone. As you just mentioned, I'm wanting to take some time and discuss some developments in terms of system simulation, as well as example of results related to quantifying the smart mobility technology impact and really focusing on energy and mobility, you know, or congestion. So when we're looking at the transportation system, and with you know, many of the previous speakers have addressed those topics, you know, looking at the system as a whole is really important, right? So when we talk about electromobility, well, obviously that means vehicle electrification, both for passenger and freight, But we also need to understand what is a charging infrastructure, what is the electrical grid. And it's not just about electrifying vehicles, it's also understanding how people and goods move within the particular system. With technology rapidly evolving, you know, connectivity and automation, you know, shared mobility, at least pre-COVID, has significantly impacted the way we move with Uber and Lyft, for example, and has changed travel behavior. Again, you know, pre-COVID, people were looking at increase in e-commerce. Well, with COVID, it has significantly accelerated with people ordering more and more. So what's really important to keep in mind is that all of these systems interact with each other, right? The penetration of electrification depends on the charging infrastructure, but also how people or freight companies are planning to use these vehicles. So to be able to study the impact of the technology at the system level, individually, but also on their interaction, we've actually, over the last 5 years, developed a workflow to explore the mobility technology impact. And so that workflow that you see on the bottom right is actually composed of about half a dozen tools that allows us to do that. So we need to first understand how people and goods move at the system level. That means large metropolitan areas. So think about, you know, 4 to 5 million people in terms of geographical area. And Polaris is the tool that we've been developing to do that. But then, you know, we need to be able to understand where are charging stations, what type of charging stations are. We need to be able to understand land use. So where are people living? Where are people working? How they are commuting?
Emmerich, sorry.
Yes.
We are not seeing your presentation. It's not shared.
I am sorry. Oh, sorry.
Thank you.
How about now?
Yes, it's okay.
All right, so sorry about that. So to be able to simulate the entire system, we need multiple tools. And so at the center is how goods and people move. And so Polaris is a full-feature activity-based model. That means we represent people, we represent goods, we represent every vehicle, but we also do represent traffic lights and stop signs and so on and so forth. And we've added all the different pieces to Polaris to be able to model the entire system. So one of the challenge of such system simulation is obviously computational efficiency. So the entire workflow runs on HPC and takes about 4 to 6 hour runtime. That's for 10 million agents. So now when we have this tool, we can answer many different questions, right? We can look at how technology impacts moves. So electrification is one of them, but also we have new type of delivery, last mile delivery, for example. We can understand how people change their purchasing decision. We just talk about it, you know, who buys an electric vehicle, where are they located, why do they buy it, how do they use it? If people change their mind on how to move, so for example, there's been with COVID a significant switch away from transit. Why does it happen? Who's doing it? And when we put all of this together, then we can understand the impact at the system level, both in terms of mobility, but also energy emission, as well as equity. So when we consider electrification and electromobility, you know, we can look at it from a different geographical area. And the first one is at the individual vehicle level. If vehicle and drivers have more information, then we can actually control them more efficiently. So we've been able to develop some control, both at the vehicle speed and powertrain, and estimated that with knowledge of the environments, for example, traffic light signal status, we can improve fuel consumption by up to 20%. So, and that's, you know, with having smoother acceleration, deceleration, you know, avoiding to stop at traffic lights, so on and so forth. Now, when we move at a larger system level, you know, things are obviously a little bit more complex. And we've developed so far models for four different metro areas: Chicago, Atlanta, Detroit, and Austin. And we've worked with our stakeholder to look at the impact of different technologies. That some of the technologies are really technical, so cooperative adaptive cruise control, for example. Some are more policy, so we'll look at freight of hours delivery. Some are looking at optimization, so on-demand shuttles, that's with Atlanta. And you know, some are also looking at infrastructure, like EV charging, for example, with Austin. And so today I wanted to share with you some examples of studies as well as results. So the first one was looking at the impact of different scenario under COVID, working with the Chicago Transit Agency. And so, you know, as you know, it's the ridership in the US, at least for Chicago, has been up as much as 80% during COVID. It's come up a little bit, but you know, not as much, not as fast as the passenger vehicles. So we look at different criteria going from service cuts to increased telecommuting, risk perception. That means, you know, people are not comfortable sharing the same space with others due to COVID, and load limits. So make people more comfortable. The city of Chicago, for example, limited the capacity of buses and trains as to how many people. And then once we look at this, even if we're focusing here on the transit experience, we can look at the impacts on the entire system from energy, emission, and equity. So one of the key aspects in understanding the different scenario and the impact is quantifying the risk perception and how it changes. So obviously with people becoming increasingly vaccinated, you know, that impacts significantly. Some people have different options. Some people don't, you know, whether you have a car or not. And then same thing for telecommuting. Some people have options to telecommute, like probably most of us in that call. But others have to be on site, you know, factory workers and so on and so forth. So we looked at this in great detail and implemented this in our model. So looking at different scenarios, and, you know, as I think, you know, we mentioned initially that some of the approach we all are trying to take are looking at impacts of policies or technologies individually, but also simultaneously. And that's really what we try to look at here. So what happens in that case when there is no service reduction or some or significant? And what does that do when combined with different telecommuting level and risk perception level? Going from, you know, going back to pre-COVID where everybody's vaccinated and comfortable, but, you know, also some intermediate scenarios. And what we've seen in terms of impacts on ridership and mobility is that, you know, there was some belief that cutting service, like avoiding service cuts in transit, making sure that the number of trains and buses remained the same as prior was sufficient. And indeed, you know, cutting them impacts significantly ridership. But what we found out is telecommuting and risk perception alone, even if with full funding, would actually still lead to significant cut in bus in ridership. So what it means is that in terms of mobility, people will, if they're not comfortable in buses sharing the same space or in trains, they would actually take their car, which is what we are seeing continuously happening in the US and also in other countries. Now, if you combine both of them, so if you cut transit and have, you know, some still some risk perception, then the long-term or even, you know, mid-term results could be drastic and continue in the future. So what does that mean in terms of mobility? And I'll just jump into just one example here is that obviously, you know, transit is the backbone of transportation. And, you know, in the US, it is a lot less developed as in France. And what we see is that if people move away from transit, we have significant increase in congestion. So that means here a decrease in average vehicle speed on the network by 20%. So that's about 10 minutes added per trip. We have about up to 19% increase in energy use. So looking at the year-to-year evolution, that's coming back 10 years from where we are right now in terms of improvements, and same thing for greenhouse gas emissions. Now, when you combine all of this together, you know, it has also significant economic impact. So when we talk about electromobility, you know, the idea is really to make sure that people and goods can move easily, so in terms of time, efficiently, and in a clean fashion, right? But in some cases, if we actually end up having more congestion, there is also an impact about the people's desire to take another trip or not. So, you know, when we looked at the overall economic impact, that's for Chicago, it's up to $7 billion over 1 year in economic activity loss from having a decrease in ridership. So that was one example on COVID. Another example is looking at impact of corporate adaptive cruise control, but taking into account also the traveler behavior, right? So what corporate adaptive cruise control allows us to do is that it allows vehicles to be a lot closer to each other, meaning that we can actually increase the number of vehicles on the road before we start having congestion. So that's overall good for the system, right? And if we're just looking at the impact of different CACC penetration, we actually see a benefit in terms of travel speed and energy. Now, what we've seen and we started to have data for is that by having the ability, let's say on the highway, to press a button and have the car drive with the driver paying less attention, if we make it too easy for the driver, it means that people will tend to take additional trips. So when we add the value of travel time as a factor, we actually having the reverse effect. So in that case, you know, CACC increase the vehicle mass travel, increase congestion, and increase energy being consumed. So it's not just how what technology is being deployed, it's how it's being deployed. So making it very easy for driver not to pay attention is actually counterproductive in terms of energy. Another example of study that is trying to nudge or influence driver decision. And so one way to do that, and that's working with Austin, is to look at road pricing. So similar to what is implemented in transit in some cities, right? The price are not the same depending on where you start and go, depending on the time of the day in trains or buses. Well, this is the same thing, except it's for vehicles and it's generalized across the entire metro. So right now in Austin, there is one existing managed toll lane. And so the idea here is to understand four strategies across the entire metro area. So starting with the baseline, the other one is fixed tolls, then area-based tolls, which you can see here on the cordon, and then congestion pricing based on speed or delay. And what we see here is that we can actually significantly improve congestion. So increase average network speed by up to 11% and also significantly reduce energy use. So, you know, these are some of the policies that are being looked at by many cities in the US and outside to try to, again, nudge people as to taking different routes and maybe changing a little bit their schedule to improve the overall system efficiency. Now, when talking about electromobility, right, there is a lot of progress being made and an acceleration in adoption in terms of vehicle electrification on the passenger side. So when we are looking at prediction, you know, where we are now and where we want to be in the future, you know, right now, the freight in the US is about a third of the energy. So it's about 10% of the vehicle mass travel, about 30% of the energy. When we're looking at some of the projection in 10, 15 years, due to significant increase in electrification on the passenger side, freight and combined with an increase in freight demand, so that coming from e-commerce and that's, you know, coming from increased population, freight could actually become half of the transportation energy in the US. And that is here including some improvements and some level of electrification on the medium and heavy duty as well. So what it means is that how passenger vehicles are used is obviously important, but how goods are moved is also critically important. And I'm come back to looking at the system of system. When we're looking at increase in e-commerce, the first thing that comes to mind is, you know, this is bad, there is more trucks. It's you know, generates more emissions, generates more traffic, so on and so forth. But what people forget is take into account the fact that we also take out some of the passenger car trips to go to shopping malls. And in the US, and also in our models, right, an average shopping trip is 7 to 8 miles each way. So you're going to the mall, you know, to buy clothes or look at something else. Now, again, on average, every additional good to be delivered is adding 1.4 miles. So we're adding 0.4 miles on freight. We're taking out 7 to 8 miles on passenger side. And this also has a primary impact on obviously the individual vehicle energy consumption, but it has a secondary impact on the traffic flow. And I'll come back to that on the freight side. But what we've noticed is, what we found out is that if we take the entire system into account and again, based on efficient delivery, so that means you don't have, you know, three trucks coming to deliver three packages to you one day, we can actually an overall net benefit at the system level in terms of energy. So another way to look at freight and the impact of electrification is to look at overnight delivery. So right now in the US, there's lots of regulations that make it pretty difficult, you know, to do so. But, you know, electrification is one of the key enabler to allow increase in overnight delivery because, you know, you obviously mind if there is a big diesel truck outside of your house that comes and does delivery or, you know, drive through. But if it's an electric vehicle, it becomes a lot more acceptable. So what we've done is we've looked at all different businesses, who could accept overnight delivery, who couldn't, what were some of the municipality constraints. And we found out that, you know, we could improve lower vehicle mass travel by 2 to 3% for the freight. You know, so because there is a lot less traffic, trucks would actually take different routes. So that means there is a significant average increase in average speed. And also a 3 to 4% in energy saving under the current limitation. Now, if we expand this with electrification, obviously a lot more possibilities on that side. So in summary, when we're looking at electromobility, you know, we need to think of a system of system approach. There is many, many metrics that sometimes are fighting against each other. Mobility versus energy is one of them, right? So from an economic point of view, we want increased mobility, we want people and goods to move more. From an energy point of view, we obviously would want to minimize some of that. Most technologies and policies also influence each other. And you know, the example of increased e-commerce is one of them, right? We obviously have an increase in that example in terms of energy consumed and number of trucks from e-commerce, but we can have a significant decrease in passenger car and overall, again, if the system operates efficiently, an overall net benefit. We also need to understand and predict travel behavior and how people make decisions. So one example we discuss is CICC, right? If you make it easy for drivers to press a button, go on the highway, they'll love it. If you make it too easy, they may love it too much. And, you know, as we've discussed with some OEMs in Detroit, they tend to spend a lot more time in the lake house in Michigan because it's a lot easier for them to go on the highway, press a button than it was in the past. The other challenge that we've discussed is unlimited number of potential scenarios. They each have their own uncertainties. And so it's not just looking at the impact of one technology at a time, but all technologies together, each one of these technologies have uncertainty. And we're really looking at, you know, what happens 5, 10, 15 years from now. So, you know, it's a very large number of potential combinations. And then, you know, some things happen slowly. such as electrification, right? We've been talking about vehicle electrification for decades, but some major events can be lead to very, very drastic change. COVID is one of them, right? Is when we're looking at freight delivery in the US, talking to some freight companies, an average day of delivery in the US right now is pretty much was their peak a couple of years ago. It was Christmas, right? So they say every day is Christmas right now in terms of freight. That was supposed to happen over the next decade. It happens in a matter of a couple of months. So, all of these are things we need to take into account. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Emily, for your presentation. I think there'll be much interest in the models that you're developing with your team. And I really invite attendees to contact us or contact you directly for more information. I'd like to mention as well that there will be at least two more events on new urban mobility. And with one looking particularly to what you just mentioned, the impact of increased teleworking and the impact of increased use of digital platforms, such as in the case of e-commerce and their impact on mobility. So looking forward to these discussions again. With that said, if there are no questions at the moment, oh, yes, I see Abdoulaye Pam is asking if, are you planning sometime soon to mix autonomous vehicles and human drive vehicles in these complex traffic models? I think maybe we have a bit of time to address that.
Yeah, we actually did that. That's one study we can share some results with. And what we've seen with, I'll say, driverless vehicle or high level of automation is one of the key is how these vehicles are used again. So we look at two main cases, one where the automated vehicle were shared, so similar to TNC, and one where they were privately owned. And if they are privately owned, you have that leads to a significant increase in empty miles with, let's say instead of having two vehicles, now one household has one vehicle, it's fully driverless, so the vehicle go back and forth, between the spouses, it takes the kids and so on and so forth. Up to 80% increase in daily vehicle mass travel is what we look at, which lead to significant congestion and significant energy increase. Now, if those driverless vehicles are shared, now you can have, 10, 15, 20 vehicle, 20 people throughout the day that share that vehicle and becomes a lot more efficient. So the technology again, I think all technologies have great potential, but they all have unintended consequences. And so, I talk about CACC as potential unintended consequences with increased vehicle mass travel. The unintended consequences are much, much greater the higher the level of automation you consider.
Thank you, Emmerich, for the answer. I hope that shedding some light for the attendance. With that said, I'd like to move on to our last presentation today, but not least, from our colleague from Université Gustave Eiffel, Rojdi Trigui. Rojdi is the deputy head of the AME department at Université Gustave Eiffel. The AME department stands for Planning, Mobilities and Environment. He's a member of the MEGEV French National Network on Energy Management and of Hybrid Electric Vehicles. He was also co-chair of the IEEE Vehicle Power Propulsion Conference in 2010. Rojdi, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Kevin, for your kind introduction. And good afternoon, everybody. And thank you for your connection to our webinar. So I will, after the presentation of Emmerich with his system of systems, I will bring you back to the vehicle, but from perspective of the behavior of the driver and its influence on the energetic performance of the electric vehicles. So the energy consumption of the electric vehicles have been introduced by Professor Alain Busquerolles in the first presentation. But here, a little reminder that it is influenced by factors that belongs to a technological family, which are the vehicle weight. So small and light materials can help to save energy in this area. and also aerodynamic shape that mainly for high speed operation, and the drivetrain efficiency, which is about the battery, motors, inverters, pneumatic, gears, and so on. And this is also important to have the most efficient drivetrain to save energy. But there are also more other factors that related to the use of the vehicles, which are, of course, the kind of the trips, urban, extra-urban, motorway, or in mountain, for example. Auxiliary use, like Professor Alain Bousquerolle said, with winter, summer use of auxiliaries for heating or air conditioning. For the charging types, now we have slow or fast chargers, so this is different with different efficiency. And if the vehicle is charged indoor and or outdoor. We have also the traffic and the infrastructure with traffic lights, congestion works, and so on. The weather and sunny, rain, snow, humidity, of course. And the driving style with the acceleration, speed, level, and braking. And why saving energy? Because EV are supposed to be efficient vehicles. But because this is impact directly the autonomy range, so we can improve. And also, if we consider only 10% of energy saved applied to EV fleets, that means that 10% of dedicated electricity is not to be produced, and this is not negligible. So I will talk about this part of driving style. And for that, I can give you a short seconds of two vehicles, but exactly the same vehicle, electric vehicle, that make a trip, the blue trip and the red trip. The blue one is a registered and a real trip. And the second one is calculated in terms of best energy. I'm sorry, So the original pattern, given that the two vehicles made exactly the same trip with the same time and the same distance, the blue one consumed 110 watt hour, and the second one, which have an optimal pattern, it's only 70 watt hour, which is to 36% of energy economy. But the whole is not the driver effect, but also could be the traffic effect. Like here, for example, the driver was obliged to slow down his vehicle. But here, for the deceleration, mainly for electric vehicles, this is a big issue, because when we brake strongly, we cannot recover the energy, and the red curve demonstrate that the deceleration and the brake must be soft in order to recover the most energy possible. So this is important and give research questions how to obtain this ideal speed profile for a given vehicle and a given trip, and then how to make drivers follow this profile. And also, what is the real potential when it is applied in real life? Because we know that to follow a speed is not often possible with the traffic. And also, what can the driver practice eco-driving without losing time? So this is also could be issue to lose time in a trip. So technological answer are always about ADAS, which stands for Advanced Driving Assistance Systems, which are always two kinds, active systems that are selected by the driver, but and then impose limitation on acceleration and speed, and also passive system, which begin from learning to the driver the eco-driving rules and also advise him in real time, or also give him performance evaluation after the trip with what we call eco score. So in this frame, we have conducted a CEV project. It's funded by SEED network. And this gathered both engineering science and human science researcher. The participants are here. I will not cite all of them. But the objective of the project, which is efficient driving for electric vehicle, is to generate eco-driving rules for the considered vehicle, present these rules instruction to the EV drivers, and then measure the impact of on the energy consumed. So the vehicle is a small C0, Citroën C0. It's a four places vehicle. And we equipped with a data logger on the CAN network, and we experiment with 100 drivers with two trips around Lyon campus of University Gustave Eiffel. The first trip, what it called P1, was without instruction, and the second trip is with eco-driving rules given to the driver just before the trip. So how to generate the rules are also the best vehicle speed in terms of energy. Here again, we use models. So this is more or less like Professor Alain Bosquerolles showed. It's the same approach with systemic modeling with different components, models of batteries, electric motors, and so on. And we have the data of the vehicles inside these models, and we consider the speed profile, and all this give us a good approximation of the battery energy consumed or recovered, because when the deceleration comes, we have the battery recovering the energy from the vehicles. And this is with good accuracy, as you can see on one trip, the power of the battery. So given this validation of the model, then we use optimization algorithm to generate the best profiles of speeds. And this is using dynamic programming. So we can see here that we consider all the combination of acceleration of the vehicle during a seconds, and then the best combination is what we can see on the right, top right. This is the best trajectory in terms of speed, optimal speed of energy. And here then we have a parametric study on the different factors that influence this speed, and we establish the eco-driven rules. This is the table we have generated, but I will not read all the table, but if, because there is many constraints that then we can introduce, like the time constraint, or if there is a slope or grade on the road. But here, if we have a high time constraint, so what is the best to do is to play more on the acceleration and not on the speed. And so this is not very intuitive, but we demonstrated that we can use a strong acceleration without losing so that optimality of energy. But we can we must have a stable speed and low speed. So this is typically what have done one of the participants between the trip one and the trip two. Here we can see that he applied the advice to lower the speed. When we have, for example, on the part of maximum speed of 70 and 90 kilometer per hours. And this is bring him to save about 10% of the energy consumption. If we see globally what has been done between TRIP1 and TRIP2 with all the drivers, so we have in the blue on the right side, the blue point is the TRIP1, and the red points are the TRIP2, and the theoretical optimal energy is in green. So we see that we have still margin to practice or to reach the theoretical optimum. But what we see is that globally, all the driver or almost all the driver have improved their energy consumption by approximately 10%. The graph on the left, we can see this is the mechanical energy for P1 and P2. And we can see that on the diagonal, only 2 points. So that means that only two drivers made a lowest score in the second trip. And all this is with respecting global average time between the two trips, which was about 26 minutes. So, as Professor Busquerol said previously, we have applied some results from the CEF project to QMAN project, which is in the University of Lille for the campus of Lille. This is in the framework of Anatole Deroveau thesis. Here, the objective, it was how it is possible to characterize the behavior driving, but the driving style varies according to the personality of a driver, but also for the same driver, it is according to the day, according if he's in hurry or in the mood of the day, and also is often coupled with the traffic effects that make difficult to have only the driver effect. So the first approach was the definition of three profiles using statistic methods that are from a CEF project with 100 drivers previously presented. But this time is only using the P1 data because this is without instruction of eco-driving. So after filtering some traffic effects, like unusual traffic jam, we have plotted on a principal components analysis approach. This is the different energy and driver classes on three axes, which are the velocity, positive acceleration and the negative acceleration, which represent the deceleration and the braking. And so we have three clusters that appears. The green one have the lowest consumption energy, and the red one have the biggest one. And so we deduced a kind of eco, middle, and sport category of drivers that are based on the center of these three classes. And the difference, if we can take the middle as reference, it's about plus or minus about 5 to 6% of difference in energy consumption. This is also, acceleration have been plotted on the right top of this slide, and give the level of acceleration for the different classes, so sport, mean, and eco of the drivers. And this is have been implemented in the driving cycle generator that has been developed by Anatole. And for the velocity, however, we consider it only approximately 95% of the maximum speed for the eco driver and 105% of the limitation speed for the sporty driver. And putting all this in the simulation tools, we have the eco, middle, and sport consumption on kilowatt hour here. And we have approximately the same dispersion that we noted in the SEV project dispersion. So in conclusion, the driving behavior is difficult to categorize, but first attempts allow to introduce disparity in simulation. And this is a good thing to have more precise estimation for Qman, for example, for the energy needed for electricity needed for establishing, for example, chargers for electric vehicle. And also the driving behavior generates large disparity in energy consumption of EVs, and we can reduce that by eco-driving practices. Simulation and optimization also can help to understand the impacts of different factors, because we can eliminate some of them, mainly traffic effect here. So for the 100 driver, practically all the drivers can understand and apply rules to reduce energy consumption of EVs. And this is impacts directly the autonomy range. And finally, different advanced driving assistance system could help implementing energy saving, but there is acceptability issues because some drivers don't accept to put this eco mode in vehicles, because it's not acceptable for them to limit acceleration or speeds. But in the future, autonomous vehicle would be a perfect application for this speed optimization. And as Emmerich said, we will have a real gain of energy when imposing the vehicle speed for all the traffic. So thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Rojdi, for your presentation. And again, here, I feel like it could be interesting to see if the experimentation in Lyon and Lille could be translated to an American context, and see like if the eco driving rules like should be the same, or if there are any variation there. That could be an interesting thing to look at. Two quick questions from the attendance I see, and we have about 10 minutes to go through some of the those questions. One was two quick questions, I think, for Emmerich, asking from Ricardo Castro if the Polaris simulation framework is freely available for academic research, and then also if the micromobility, like e-bikes and scooters and ride sharing, were considered as part of the last mile mobility. Emmerich, if you want to.
Sure. Yes. So we've been working to make Polaris and other models available to outside research organizations. We've actually talking with many people on that call about doing that, and some universities and private companies are already using it. So feel free to contact me, and we can close the loop on that. In terms of last mile, we've recently integrated e-scooters and e-bikes, including docking and non-docking. So that is now part of the studies. The results I shown did not include those options, but they are available now.
Thank you. And I see Ayu Barwa was asking, I think, for Rojdi, if you could maybe explain why the acceleration does not have a big impact on energy consumption when comparing the results of eco and sport modes.
Yes, the first impacting parameters is really speed, and this is because the energy consumed with aerodynamic effect is the square of the speed. So this we increase the speed and the energy is increased two times. But the acceleration is a second factor. It's also impacting. But when we impose a time trip, this is one constraint of our optimization, is not to lose time. We demonstrated that it is better to increase acceleration and not to increase speed to reach this time. So that's why also acceleration is a second, is not of first effect, and we can play on acceleration. And another thing that it is also, I think, not very, it's not true for all motorization, is that when we accelerate strongly, we use the motors on a good points of efficiency. And so this is could play also from sometimes.
Thank you, Rojdi. And I think there was a more general question, but Abdulrahman was asking how much would machine learning tools help the instruction algorithm over time if it is applied? I think that Rojdi, if you want to say something.
Yes, that's what I put it in the conclusion, but I think I didn't say it. It's today we are using artificial intelligence to capture the driver behavior. So I think this will help. Because it could help to capture if also the driver is able to accept the advices of the algorithm by analyzing his driving style all the days or some days or the hour of the days. So I think this is ongoing, I think, trends.
And I think maybe, Emeric, you have something else to say on this, since you mentioned HPC.
Yeah, and a lot of the, so AI and ML is useful for many different purposes, you know, on the control side, as Rosie mentioned, but it's also very helpful to enable optimization and large-scale simulation. So what we're doing right now, for example, with Polaris is we're developing surrogate model that allows us to simplify some of the physics behind the system and the decisions, and really to allow us to use these models along with optimization algorithms. So, you know, when we need to run thousands and thousands of simulation, I mean, it's great to have HPC, but still you need to be fast. And AI and ML is, you know, can be used in many different ways. That's one of them, is actually enabling large scale system control and optimization.
Thank you for your answers. And I just wanted to go back to the provocative question that we had earlier and give a chance for our panelists to maybe address this question and bring their opinion. I think, Eric, you had some things to say on this.
Sure, yeah, this is the question about which country is better prepared for transitioning to clean cities or green cities, right? So I think, right, I'm willing to tackle the provocative question, but I would say my answer is that I think, having lived in both places a bit, that France is probably better prepared. I think part of it is like a natural geography thing, right? French cities are much more dense because they're much older. The climate conditions are more amenable. But I also think it's partly like a cultural and preference thing. So when I think, so now this is where it gets really sensitive, but when I think about, you know, what do Americans want? What do French people want? Now everyone can tell me I'm wrong, but you know, I think Americans maybe want things that are harder to decarbonize. So when I think of Americans, I think like, okay, you want a big house, you want a big car, and already this is challenging to decarbonize. You know, I don't know if those are as central to the French identity that I think, you know, what do the French want? is getting dangerous, but I'll say it. I think, you know, good quality of life, but, you know, a good lunch and a pleasant 3-week vacation in the summer. And I think those things, you know, can be provided in ways that are low carbon. I also think that it's true for both cultures that people don't like to be told what to do. That's probably true for, you know, most Western cultures, most cultures, period. But I also think the French maybe are more, you know, communally, socially minded than Americans are, for various reasons. So as far as behavior goes, you know, I think a lot of energy transition things will require some change in behavior, and I feel like French people are better prepared for that. I mean, there is one advantage I think that Americans have, which is the sort of love of new technologies. That you know, Americans love new things just because they're new. So in that sense, you know, Americans won't mind jumping to new technologies if they think it won't make them change their lifestyle. Like, so for example, today actually, Ford is unveiling the Ford F-150 Lightning. So it's the first electric pickup truck. And so for people who don't know, in the US, the number one selling vehicle is actually the F-150 pickup truck, better than every sedan, every small vehicle. So the fact that they're coming out with an electric version of that, that's really interesting. But, you know, technology isn't the only thing that will help us transition to green cities.
And before I leave the floor to other panelists to comment, I must say that there was no pointers given to Eric in his answer. So he's really speaking his mind freely. So on our side there, I just want to mention that. Maybe Alain, if you have a word to add.
Yes, it was an interesting webinar, because in fact, we have to raise very difficult question. I like the concept of Emric, a system of system. There is no ideal solution. It's very complex how to face this complexity. We have to develop advanced simulation tools in the different parts. We see that it's very interesting. And finally, it's complex to predict what can be happen. And because of great variability of usage, of prices, and so on. What is interesting in our collaboration is that we really work together. We enrich each other, and we try to face this complexity. And we need to develop more advanced tools to do that and to work together. And it's not so obvious. There is a question in the chat asking, what is the solution to apply test to a city today? From my point of view, we don't know. We don't know. And I believe that the interest of what is presented today is that we gain in expertise in order to have maybe a response in future. But nowadays it's very, very difficult.
Thank you, Anna, for your words. I don't know if any of the other panelists, do you want to add maybe some final word? And if not, then we will be wrapping up the event. Okay, I don't see any more comments to add. Thank you also to Jean-François Baudard, who just wanted to thank all the presenters today. And he mentioned that it was an inspiring webinar, even for a non-specialist. I maybe just want to mention as well that in March, we launched a transatlantic network for young researchers and professionals to help students and recent graduates or PhD postdocs to better get to know each other, better get to know the ecosystems of research in France and the US, the centers of expertise. So there's more information on our websites, and I'll be providing attendees with more information afterwards as well. Feel free to pass on the word, and we are always happy to connect with people interested in urban issues. And with that said, thank you all very much for attending. Thank you to all panelists for participating and making this event possible. And yeah, have a good day, everyone, and see you soon.
Bye.
Thanks all.
Bye-bye.